All right, let us start the post-tea session. Welcome you all. In this session, we'll have two talks, one by Professor Karthik Raman of the Department of Biotechnology in IIT Madras, and the second one by Professor Paul Glendening of the University of Manchester, UK. So we start by the talk by Professor Karthik Raman on learning and predicting novel metabolic pathways through subgraph mining. Professor Raman.
So thanks a lot for the invitation to this meeting. I really enjoy coming to ICTS. I was here last year as well. And I'm going to talk about a sort of, I think this talk is going to be quite different from some of the other talks you've been listening to today. And I think most talks are different from one another because, you know, you get to sample a lot of interesting area. So today I'm going to talk to you about how we studied a complex network, which is the metabolic network that exists within, say, any living cell, right? And how we went about predicting pathways. This is a very common problem, as I'll come back to in a moment. I'll just start with a brief overview of our lab and what we do, because it's probably, you know, good to know if, you know, you want to see think of a collaboration and so on. So we are an interdisciplinary group focusing on the development of algorithms, especially to understand and manipulate biological networks, and we emphasize a lot on metabolic networks. So most of our work concerns metabolic networks. The key application we envisage is, for metabolic engineering. We come up with strategies to overproduce different kinds of compounds, like say vitamin E or hyaluronic acid and things like that. Commercially important compounds, using strategies from computational modeling. And we also do a lot of integrated analysis of multiomic data that's a little orthogonal to the first thing that we do. And we also actively participate in the initiative for biological systems engineering. I'll tell you a little about it if I have time today, or maybe certainly tomorrow. And as Arun was mentioning, the Robert Bosch Center for Data Science and AI, which has been set up at IIT Madras. So these are the key methodologies in our that we use in our lab. So network biology is what's probably of most interest to most of you. And constraint-based modeling is another very important aspect of the work that we do. And I've lectured about it last year here at ICTS. And of course, you know, can't do much of what we do without either high-performance computing or machine learning is, again, central to a lot of what we do. So today's talk sort of combines these two areas. And this is the entire gamut of stuff that we actually work on in our lab. So trying to predict synthetic lethals in metabolic networks. So how do you pick out combinations of genes that are lethal to a network? And they're like very similar to minimal cut sets for all the mathematicians out here. And metabolic engineering, biological data analysis. And a key area is, you know, we've been working on in the recent years is trying to engineer microbial consortia. So it's like not studying a single isolated metabolic network, but like say, what happens when you put a couple of these metabolic networks together and so on. And I will talk about a bit of this tomorrow as well. And this is something maybe, you know, I can convince Arun to give a talk on sometime soon. This is work we've been doing with Arun and trying to design regulatory networks using a control theoretic strategy rather than the brute force approaches that people have used in the past. I'll start with a brief history of graph theory. I think, is there anybody who doesn't know this? I hope there's at least like one person for whom this is new. But it's always fun to, you know, as I was telling Arun just now, that pay your respects to Euler before you're bringing any mathematical talk, right? So Euler's basically contributed to so many different branches of mathematics. This is a problem set in the Prussian city of Königsberg in 1735. So the city's residents had a very interesting question, you know, after my dinner or something, can I just start out from my house, which could be anywhere here, cross all these bridges exactly once, and come back home? Right? This is the classic introduction to graph theory. So what did Euler do? He made this kind of a diagram, and his solution to this problem laid the foundations of graph theory. And I really like the letter Euler wrote. So he says, thus you see, most noble sir, how this type of solution bears little relationship to mathematics. And I don't understand why you expect a mathematician to produce it rather than anyone else. For the solution is just based on reason. And its discovery does not depend on any mathematical principle. And he says, you know, tongue-in-cheek, that I do not know why even questions which bear so little relationship to mathematics are better solved by mathematicians than others. Okay? And even better, this question is so banal, but it seemed to be worthy of attention that neither geometry, nor algebra, nor counting was sufficient to solve it. So this was Euler's sort of summary of solving this problem. What did he do? He basically constructed the first ever graph. Right? So he converted the this picture, this map sort of thing, into a graph. And so here the nodes or vertices are nothing but the different islands in the city, and every edge is obviously a bridge that was there in the city. So can you find the walk that the citizens were looking for? I think most of you might know that. That doesn't exist. So Euler proved that there is no Eulerian circuit in this graph. In fact, after this, in my undergrad course, I go on to talk about the Hamiltonian circuit and how it's got like such close relationship with biology. You can't sequence a single human genome, or I mean, forget even a human genome, a bacterial genome, without you know, graph theory today. So what are graphs? So more formal introduction. They are a very important theme in computer science, defined by a set of vertices and edges. So vertices are certain entities, and the edges represent the relationships between those entities. And they're often referred to as networks, road networks, social networks, of course, metabolic networks, protein interaction networks, gene regulatory networks, and so on. And the graphs are classified elaborately, which influences the choice of algorithms you kind of employ on them. And this has bearing on what I'll talk to you tomorrow. So you have directed or undirected graphs. I'm sure most of you are familiar where, you know, I think Arun was also alluding to that. Weighted versus unweighted graphs. And labeled versus unlabeled graphs. It's actually sort of important in the context of today's talk, as I'll show you, and so on. And there are also what are known as bipartite graphs. I'll talk to you about this tomorrow, because tomorrow's talk is about how do you find paths in enumerate paths in a bipartite graph, and so on, and which can be considered equivalent to hypergraphs. So hypergraphs, very quickly, are, you know, an edge does not necessarily involve two nodes, but it could be any number of nodes. So a hyper edge can connect any number of nodes in the graph. So why graphs? And so social networks or social scientists have contributed a lot. So they have questions like, do I know someone who knows X? So is there a path that exists? How long is that chain to X, which is a shortest path problem? And this is a very nice 20th anniversary paper on Watson-Strugat's classic small world network theory paper, which appeared, I think, about last week or so. 20th anniversary paper, which talks about the 6 degrees of separation and things like that. You know, things like identifying connected components and who has the most friends, right? You know, most connected nodes and centrality analyses. But of course, you know, I'm not so interested in social networks, but we ask the exact same questions of biological networks. Is there a way to produce a metabolite X from A? The existence of a path. How long is that series of reactions? So the shortest path problem. You know, are all proteins in an organism connected to one another, and so on? So it's typically, we call it the giant strong component in these networks, and so on. And this is actually a question of a lot of interest, not just to me, but to many other people who've been working in this area. What are the most influential protein in a network? There are various ways to look at it. The classic thing is just like degree and so on, but then you have page rank and you know, eigenvector centrality and what have you. So, and many biological problems map back naturally onto graph problems, like pathfinding in a metabolic network, identifying important proteins in a network, clusters of proteins, communities of proteins, and so on. And of course, as I was mentioning, assembling reads from an exgenome sequencer. And so on. There are many problems that naturally back onto graphs. So graph theory is like a very powerful tool for biologists today. And chemoinformatics, which is loosely what I'll talk to you about. You must have all heard of bioinformatics. It's used by informatics and biology together, how informatics has impacted biology. Chemoinformatics is more towards chemistry. So you can think of my talk today as sort of computer science meets biochemistry. So what is it that we did? So we tried to learn and predict novel metabolic pathways through something known as subgraph mining, or like subnetwork mining. Metabolic networks have been curated for hundreds of organisms. A metabolic network is nothing but a long list of reactions happening in an organism. Essentially, A plus B going to C plus D a few thousand times. There are different kinds of reactions, different kinds of metabolites that mix and match and interact in different ways with one another to form other metabolites in a cell. Right? By metabolite, I mean a chemical, a compound. You know, I might be using these terms interchangeably, but they're basically nothing but some glucose plus ATP giving glucose 6-phosphate plus ADP kind of reaction. There are about 10,000 plus reactions known in many of the databases already, which represent the spectrum of conversions that known enzymes can actually carry out today, right? And a lot of metabolic engineering involves copy-pasting these reactions from, you know, one organism into another. So if you may have heard, a very important anti-malarial drug called artemisinin was produced in this fashion. They took a few reactions from Artemisinia annua, which is a plant which produces this interesting metabolite, just stuck them into yeast, which is a very, you know, helpful organism in the labs and can be easily fermented to produce many of these compounds. Right? And the question now is, how do we predict pathways for any given compound? And this is the classic high school question, which I think most of you must have seen and solved. You have an A, or you know, something like chlorobenzene or whatever. Something like this. How do you actually accomplish this? This is a classic question that, you know, most of us have encountered in school. And, you know, based on your rote memory of organic chemistry, you would say, you know, you employ this Diels-Alder reaction or a Kolb-Schmidt reaction or so on to basically affect that conversion from the left-hand side to the right-hand side. The question we ask today is much the same. I have a compound on the left-hand side and I want to convert it to a compound on the right-hand side. But, of course, instead of my memory of organic reactions, can I learn something from all these databases that exist? Can I learn the kind of conversions that enzymes can catalyze to predict a pathway? And most interestingly, the question we want to ask is, can you come up with ways to make compounds that are not already known in the databases? It's not that we'll divine new chemistries, but using known chemistries, can you make compounds that are not already seen? And this is a very interesting aspect of our algorithm. And can we fill gaps in these metabolic networks? There's a lot of interest being generated recently on what's known as underground metabolism. So there's a lot of metabolism that's already known, but there's a lot that's happening underground. We still do not know that these reactions exist, but we have telltale signs that these reactions do exist. You know, you find one stray metabolite here in some metabolomics analysis and so on, but you still don't have unequivocal proof that this reaction does exist. Right, but this is something that we could figure based on this. And if you look at any network, right, you can have several paths. Right? So how do you figure the best path, the most biologically plausible path? So I'm sure if you started a network long enough, you can find 10 ways to do glycolysis, glycolysis being the most basic biochemical pathway, if you will. Right? There are like probably 10 different ways to do glycolysis. Why does the cell do it in one particular fashion? Right? I think, you know, the common wisdom is delta G, but we'll show here that that need not necessarily be the case. It's easy to interpret what the cell does in a much simpler fashion. And obviously, we are not the first people to do it. There are lots of very nice tools out there which do a very similar thing. There's RetroPath, PathPred, and so on. The one catch in all of these tools is that practically all of them rely on the existence of the query molecules in the database. So if you go and say, you know, I want to produce this X, if the algorithm hasn't seen X, it doesn't know what to do with X. And or they rely on hand-curated reactant mapping. I'll tell you what this is in a moment. Right? So some sort of rules that say, you know, what's a mechanism or what's happening in this reaction and things like that. Right? So those kind of intricate details about which involves, you know, more expert knowledge coming in. Our question was simple. Can we build a fully automated engine that relies only on structural information to predict these pathways? So this is easy and cheap. Right? You have databases already which list all the reactions. They name the chemicals that are involved. And you have databases of structure as well. And by structure, we just mean, you know, 2D structure kind of, not like, you know, coordinates or something like that. Right? So I need to know what are all the atoms that this carbon is involved with in some sense. So what's our approach? This is our pipeline, which we call reaction miner. So every molecule, step back, is represented as a graph. Now, some of you may be familiar with metabolic networks, and I was alluding to them before, where every node is a metabolite and so on. But now, discard that idea. Now, every molecule is a graph, right? And I'll walk you through this in a moment. And then we do a very interesting thing called reactant product mapping. And this is at the core of our algorithm. All these are actually very straightforward things, which, if you very intuitive to think of, but hard to implement in practice on an algorithm in a reliable fashion, right? So suppose you have the classic glycolysis reaction. This will help me for tomorrow's talk as well. So suppose you have glucose. I'm using a very simplified short form. G plus ATP giving G6P plus ADP. Right? This is like the first reaction of glycolysis. Happens all the time in your body. Right? So what happens is glucose interacts with ATP. One phosphate group jumps to glucose. It becomes glucose-6-phosphate. And ATP becomes ADP. The catch is, as I'll again mention to you tomorrow, if you represented this as a non-bipartite graph, you might say G, ATP, and G6P, ADP. Something like this. Whatever is on the left-hand side connects to whatever is on the right-hand side. It's a very simple way to represent a network. But then you could come up with weird conclusions. You may think that glucose can be easily converted to ADP. And anybody who knows biology here, you may assume that ADP can be directly converted to pyruvate, which gives you a two-step glycolysis instead of the 10-step glycolysis that actually occurs in nature. This is because, even somebody with little experience can tell you that here the actual reaction happening is glucose becomes G6P and ATP becomes ADP. Right? This is the transformation that's really occurring. There is an enzyme, of course, called hexokinase, which does this job, but that converts glucose to glucose-6-phosphate with the help of ATP. Right? So these are all like helper molecules, and there are approaches which basically label the helper molecules and do the analysis. But what we did is we just tried to use the structure to figure out what is getting converted to what. I'll talk to you about that in a moment. And then we use something known as subgraph mining, which is basically nothing but learning graphs, recognizing subgraphs that exist in the reactant and the product, and use this to incrementally build pathways and so on. So we identify what is known as the reaction center, the place where the reaction is happening, and the reaction signature, which we say is a subgraph which is necessary for the reaction to occur. And then we identify what are known as reaction rules, which tell you when a particular reaction can happen. So every reaction rule sort of captures the mind of an enzyme. And then we create a reaction rule network, where every node is a reaction rule, and edges connect rules that can be successively applied. Because we build this formulation, it now turns out that any sort of A to B that I was talking about there is nothing but a pathfinding on this network. And pathfinding is very simple, right? But you can't do regular pathfinding. You have to do some more, apply some weights and so on. So I'll now go in detail into each of the steps that I listed on the previous slide. The first is conversion of a molecule to an undirected graph. So this is D-lactic acid. And if you see, every atom is now represented by a node. And every bond is now represented by an edge. And a double bond is represented by a different label. So there's a 2 on this, if you can see it. And I also have a wedge and a dash to account for the stereochemistry. Because there's, if you don't honor stereochemistry, there's very little you can do in biology. So what are the data set that we use? We use this classic database called the KEK, which is the Kyoto Encyclopedia of Genes and Genomes, which has about 10,065 reactions. And we also obtained organism-specific data sets. So suppose you want to see if this pathway is possible inside of E. coli, right? So the whole universe of reactions tells you what's possible in all known living cells. But if you want to see if this pathway happens inside of yeast, and how can I take it from somewhere else and put it into yeast and so on. right? But we have some one major issue is that cake contains no information about reversibility. So the current, very simplifying assumption is that every reaction can proceed in both directions. So this, although did not hurt our method, surprisingly, but it's easy to extend it to other databases, and we are working on it right now. And we also synthetically expanded the cake. I'll not get into the details, but just to see how scalable our algorithm is. Because, in the future, you might have reaction databases that have a few hundred thousand reactions compared to the thousand. So will this method work? So we wanted to check that out too. So this is all inside of living cells. So they are they're mostly roughly under the same temperature, yeah. But there could be some, there are extremophiles though, which live in 70 degrees and things like that. So I'm not sure to what extent those reactions have been characterized, but that's an important point to look at, right? So the first point is to predict a pathway, but then, all these feasibility analyses can be done. Right? Because a plant can do something, it may not be easy to just take that and put it inside yeast, right? But it has also worked. So it is important to look at feasibility, and I think, temperature is certainly one of the things that we should look at, but something that we often don't pay attention to because, most living cells live in a... So the first important aspect of our method is what's known as this reaction product mapping. So I want to map glucose to glucose-6-phosphate and ATP to ADP. How do I do that? So let's look at a slightly different reaction here. So we have some A plus B plus carbon dioxide giving C plus D plus oxygen. This is a reaction. So we first eliminate some simple molecules like this to avoid confusion. We have like a short blacklist of molecules that we shouldn't map, like carbon dioxide, oxygen, water, and things like that. But then now, we need to find out whether, which molecules are getting paired. So what we do is we compute what is known as subgraph edit distance. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the concept of edit distance. So if you have, it's commonly used, all of you have used the edit distance algorithm when you typed a message today, right? So the spell check works on the concept of edit distance. So the spell check will tell you the words that are closest in number of edits to the word that you misspelled while typing out a message, right? The concept is identical here. You find a graph that is closest to another graph. So you find a bunch of atoms and bonds that are closest to what's on the left-hand side. So if you look at 206, and it is subgraph edit distance, not graph edit distance. So if there is a subgraph that is identical, the distance becomes zero, as you see here. So first we map out these two pairs, and then we map out these two. So how this works is that we first map 20631 and 00152. These are all cake IDs. Maybe I should have put in names, but it doesn't matter what these molecules are. And now we eliminate any other pair involving those molecules, and then map what is left. Right? So this gives us a mapping, and it turns out that this type of mapping is remarkably accurate. It almost is comparable to what is known as K-Gar pair, which is hand-curated. So I think our accuracy was like, our precision was about 87%, and our recall was like close to 98%, and so on. The next question is, how do we now quantify the structural change happening from reactant to product? So the basic idea is, you have a molecule on the left-hand side, which became a molecule on the right-hand side. I need to understand what happened here. What did the enzyme really do? And now see if that enzyme can do it to a related molecule, because this is what enzymes do. Enzymes work on many related substrates. So our hypothesis is that there is a reaction center, a place where bonds are changing. So there is a C double bond, there's a CNH2 which goes off here and which is now replaced by a COH or something like that. So a reaction center for a pair AB, the set of vertices in B to which new edges are added or removed from the left-hand side, right? And now the reaction signature is nothing but the immediate neighborhood, right? So this is our way of looking at specificity, because not every an enzyme, if there is a COOH that becomes a C double bond O, it's not possible, it's not that it will happen wherever that bond exists. Right? There is some neighborhood, there is some chemistry around that site which influences the enzyme. So we are capturing that by the one-hop neighborhood. It's fairly simplistic, but has worked very well, you know. But I think we can easily extend it to higher order neighborhoods, you know, with some computational cost and so on. And then we look at the structural change. There is a subgraph that's being removed from the left-hand side and a subgraph that is being added to the right-hand side. Or basically, you know, a bond that is lost and a bond that is added. Right? There is a CNH2 on this side, which becomes a COH on the other side. Now, that could be some inter-reaction center bond changes and so on. I'll not get into those complexities, but those are also handled readily by our algorithm. So let's look at an example. So here you have asparagine and aspartic acid. So there is a COH that is added here at the cost of a CNH2. And suppose you look at a more simple alcohol dehydrogenase, there is ethanol that becomes acetaldehyde. So there is a C double bond O that becomes a CHO, and so on. And similarly for propanol as well, right? There's a C double bond, there's a COH that becomes a C double bond O, if you look at an alcohol dehydrogenase. Yeah, it's basically a graph. Yeah, it's actually represents an adjacency list for faster computations and so on, but it's just a graph, right? So the subgraph is also represented as, you know, any other graph as an adjacency list. We use this software called C-tree, which is very fast. So for each pair AB, we store the rule, which comprises what is the reaction center, what is the reaction signature that's necessary, what is the overall structural change that has happened, and if there are any helper reactants that were involved. This is what a biologist would call a cofactor. We've just simplified it here. So how do we go about pathway prediction? So given a target product molecule B, the rule L is applicable on B if the signature in L and the subgraph that was added is a part of B. Right? So B. The subgraph is changing, but for every reaction, you'll have a bunch of subgraphs that are bonds or subgraphs that are added and removed. Right? So now if I want to see, we're just looking at one molecule. Right? So I will talk you through an example. So suppose you look at, say, this example, right? So there is hexanal, which is an aldehyde, and this is an alcohol, right? So if this is getting converted to this, normally this is the reaction. So COH becomes a C double bond O. So whenever I find a COH, I'll try and see if it could have come from a C double bond O. Right? That's the logic I apply to trace back the reactions. So to apply the rule L, we now convert B to B minus the subgraph that was added. It's a little circuitous because we always go from right to left. So from B, you remove the subgraph that was added. And to A, you add the subgraph that was removed to recreate A and B. You have this very example for a pair of molecules that you've learned from the database, but if you encounter a new example, this is how you would go about it. You'll find an OH, replace it with a double bond O, and see if this double bond O can be made in some other way and so on. I'll talk you through a full example in a moment. Okay? So each node in the network is a reaction rule, and it just connects rules that can be successively applied. Right? So if you have an aldehyde, it'll have a bunch of reaction rules. The moment you go to an alcohol, it'll have a different set of rules that can be applied. It'll have a different set of edges that emanate from it. And this captures the dependencies among the reaction rules and how they can be applied in sequence to identify pathways. And pathway prediction is nothing but finding the path on this rule network. Right? So a reactant of a given rule must contain this subgraph. It should have the signatures corresponding to this, and it should minus the subgraph that was added as part of this rule, plus the subgraph that was removed in this rule. Right? So if you have it should have an aldehyde or something, but you know it should have lost a COH, so the left-hand compound must have the OH or something like that, and so on. And similarly, a rule L1 is applicable on a reactant of L2. If this graph G1, if L1 has this graph G1, this is L1 dot the reaction signature of L1, and the subgraph added here, and that should be a part of this G2. I think it will become clearer with an example. So let's just take a very simple database, which has only two reactions. So there is an aldehyde that becomes an acid, and an alcohol that becomes an aldehyde. Right? So this is nothing but your classic alcohol dehydrogenase, and this is another enzyme which converts an aldehyde to an acid. So you have a COH that's converted to a CHO, or a C double bond O, in this case, and there is a C double bond O, CH, that becomes a COH here, essentially. Right? But then, you know, it needs to have had a double bond O in the neighborhood and things like that. Otherwise, this enzyme wouldn't have acted on it. So, now let's say I want to figure out how to produce hexanoic acid from hexanal. Right? And neither of these query molecules are in our reaction database. Right? Our reaction database has only these four molecules: propanol, propanal, ethanol, ethanol, acetaldehyde. So only these four molecules are there in our database. First, search for a rule that's applicable on the target molecule, which is hexanoic acid. In our two-node network, L2 is applicable because it has the C double bond O. Because this acid signature is there, I say let's apply the rule L2, which is, you know, how do you produce an acid from an alcohol? And on applying L2 on from an aldehyde, on applying L2 on hexanoic acid, hexanal is generated as the reactant pair because we had this propanal becoming propanoic acid or whatever. So we now check if you've reached the source, right? We wanted to convert hexanol to hexanol to hexanoic acid, right? So since we've still not reached the source, we try to see if there is one more set of rules that can be applied to extend the pathway and produce the original source. So since L1 is connected from L2, we are guaranteed that L1 is applicable on the reactant produced by L2. Right? Because and on applying L1 on hexanal, hexanol is generated as the reactant pair, completing the query. So essentially what you do is, you find that there is an acid signature, you jump back to an aldehyde, you find that there is an aldehyde signature, you jump back to the alcohol, and now you know that this is how you generalize these two reactions to produce hexanol, or like hexanoic acid from hexanol. So what we get finally is hexanol, apply the rule L1 to hexanal, apply the rule L2 to hexanoic acid. This is a very simplified example, but obviously, you know, if we can work on complex examples as well. The next question is, how do you find paths in this network? Right? All of you know that, you know, path finding can be done by regular breadth first search, which just tries to find shortest paths in a network. But it turns out that that does not use the, you know, the information that we have about the source and so on, or the structures very well. And most importantly, it does not give us biologically plausible paths. So now we said, why don't we try to do a sort of a shortest path, but at the same time minimize the transformation happening in every step. Because enzymes don't carry out wholesale structural transformations. Every enzyme is very specialized. It'll do a small structural change. You know, it'll just take one C double bond O, take it into a COH. The next enzyme will take that COH and make it into CH or whatever, and so on. Right? So we said, you optimize the distance to source and also minimize structural changes. So find the best way to go from point A to point B, like your shortest path problem, but in terms of short steps. Don't make big jumps. And this, it turned out, that was able to capture the biology very well. So I'll show you some of your results. So this is a heuristic, which we call HD. It consistently ranks our natural pathways higher. So this is a bunch of naturally occurring pathways. Except that, you know, if you see the first example, we've split glycolysis into two paths, two five-step pathways, because the amount of chemical variety that you get in more than five steps is just too much for any algorithm to handle, not just ours. So, and you do not want to engineer more than five steps into any organism as well. You want to keep the engineered pathway as short as possible. So here what we have is, we have a five-step reaction from glucose to glyceraldehyde and glyceraldehyde to pyruvate. It turns out that the shortest path applying this heuristic was actually the correct glycolysis. And in this case, it was ranked second. So if you see and if you compare it with the other algorithms, there's like root search, which is very popular, but it somehow doesn't find paths to many of these pathways. And then there's metabolic root explorer, which is again very good, but it's again not able to, in some cases it performs as well or even better than our algorithm. But in most cases, we basically outperform. And if you see, the top pathway is almost in the top three or occasionally six and seven. I'll tell you why some of these are. You know, it's clearly in many of these cases, the energy considerations predominate. Right? We carefully avoided using any other information than structure. So just to, you know, it's almost your baseline for performance. And if you can include delta G or information like that, we'll be able to even perform better. So, and our predictions are very good. So we looked at it for many interesting targets. So itaconate, naringenin, resveratrol, these are important commercial compounds. And we do find very good pathways to these. You know, it's similar to these, or occasionally shorter, or more closer to the native pathway and things like that. I'll not get into the details. Interesting part is, we can also predict pathways to molecules that are not in the database. So these are three molecules that are not in the database, and it turns out that we can predict a very plausible pathway to these reactions, to these metabolites using our algorithm. And there is not even a way for the other methods to, you can't even input a compound that's not in the database and so on. So this is like an important aspect of our method, wherein you don't even need to have seen the compound before, you can still predict a pathway. So there are limitations, so I think it's, I think many of you will agree that it's not, it's important to consider thermodynamics, because it's the predominating factor in many of the biochemical reactions and so on. But the issue is that it's very difficult to get accurate measurements of delta G and so on. There are estimates of delta G, so that will be layer on layer of prediction, which may not augur very well. And we are severely limited by the accuracy of KIG, but it's easy to extend it to other databases, as we are trying to work on right now. And it is somewhat difficult to predict longer pathways, but as I said, it may not be interesting to predict very long pathways, because the reliability in terms of engineering will anyway go down. Forget the prediction. So to summarize, we've built a completely automated pipeline for prediction and pathway prediction and ranking. The core of this involves an efficient reactant product mapping, which is built on subgraph distance. And we've identified reaction signatures, which is essentially the subgraph necessary for a reaction to occur, like the presence of an aldehyde group or whatever. And we stuck all this information into a reaction rule network, which enabled us to predict pathways, even to unseen metabolites. And a key aspect of our work was this heuristic, which helped us to capture, rank these pathways in a sort of biologically plausible fashion, right? So, and it was nothing but minimize the extent of transformation happening in each step. And we showed this by recovering many known native pathways. This is important because it's not that we picked the best pathway in the top five or top six out of like 10 or so. About like 80, 100 choices there, out of which we were able to pick the best pathway and so on. So this means a lot. And I didn't talk about other aspects of accuracy and scalability of our work. We did some systematic cross-validation and tests to check the scalability and so on. And very importantly, we only use the chemical structures. So it can be readily extended to other databases and things like that. You don't need information like delta G, which is hard to obtain. And our tool is available from GitHub. You can use it. And we are trying to build a web server, which will increase the adoption, I'd imagine. And our paper is in bioinformatics, if you want to take a look. And So Arvind was the dual degree student from computer science who did most all the coding and a lot of the analysis and so on. And Shyan is my collaborator from IIT Madras, who's unfortunately moved to IIT Delhi. But I think he was very instrumental in getting this thing going, because there's no way we could have done all of this without the kind of efficient data structures that they were implementing and the tools that they had. So I think I have a minute, is it? So I'll quickly rush through you know, an initiative we have at IIT Madras. So this is something that you may want to think about if you want to establish any collaborative ties with us. So we have an initiative for biological systems engineering. Again, we are an interdisciplinary group involving chemical engineers, computer scientists, and so on. Major idea is to integrate multidimensional data across scales to again understand, predict, and manipulate complex biological systems. And we want to draw on the existing strengths at IIT Madras in terms of quantitative sciences and engineering. We work on biological network analysis, machine learning, and so on. And Himanshu and I coordinate it, and there's Professor Ashok Venkat Raman from Cambridge who's been closely involved with this initiative. And Mani is one of our new faculty. He's joined at the beginning of this year. And Swagatika, Ravindran, Raghu, and of course Arun and other people are also associated with the activities. And we have a lot of ongoing projects. I'll just mention a few of them, and some of these are network related, so it might be of interest. So predicting essential proteins in biological networks, doing community detection in for disease, identifying disease modules, and so on. So this is our lab, and I'll be happy to take any questions. Thanks for your attention.
Questions, comments?
Yeah. So you have mentioned about the reaction of glucose with ATP to produce G6P and ADP. Let's say like you have a reaction like where alcohol and acid reacts to form an ester. So in that case, how will the product...
Oh, yeah. Very good. I think I gave a simplistic example. I'll just repeat the question. So in my example, I had A plus B giving C plus D. So his question is about, say, a condensation reaction or a decomposition reaction where you have A giving B plus C or A plus B giving C or something like that, which is why we actually started off with graph edit distance and it wasn't working out. So now we use subgraph edit distance, so it's able to capture. So we have this mapping. A will get mapped to both B and C. So you can think of it like either ways. Like, you know, like AB is the main reaction and C is the helper, or AC is the main reaction and B is the helper. Either ways, we are able to recoup the original reaction. But that's a fair point.
Any other question?
So subgraph looks for even a small subgraph that is a part. So so graph is the whole graph in its entirety. Subgraph looks at only a set of nodes, right? So in graph at a distance, you want to convert this.
The questions are answered. I request the next speaker to set it up.
So you have the whole first graph, and you want to see how do you convert this entire graph to this, right? So if it has a matching subgraph, so let's say you have a I made a simplistic example. So this is a graph A. This is a subgraph A, and this is a graph. You know, there are three more nodes here and one more node. So the graph edit distance between these two would be two or something like that, because there is like two edges that need to be added to this guy to make it same as this. But the subgraph edit distance is actually zero, because both of them have A. Right? Because there is both these graphs have this subgraph exactly embedded, so there is zero graph distance between the subgraph distance between these two. Although the graph edit distance would be two or whatever. So it works on I think a dynamic programming algorithm which tries to find the best way to match these two. So what the least possible distance that you can get. It's similar to edit distance that will use. So suppose you have a cap, right? You can say you have CAT, you delete a T and you add a P, which is two edits. But that's wrong because actually a T is being changed to a P. You basically describe what are all the rules that are allowed, what are all the edits that are permissible, right? So it's typically by insertion, deletion, and a substitution. It's similarly for graphs, you can say I permit the addition of a node, addition of an edge between existing nodes, and so on. So what are the number of edits that you need to do to change from the graph on one side to the other, or subgraph on one side to the other.
Yes.
Which were they have not been synthesized, or I didn't quite
get it. They're not there in the databases yet. So,
but they are found in nature.
They are found in nature. Oh. So in fact, those were compounds that are present in this in Mycobacterium tuberculosis, the one that causes TB, and they've been in the breath of TB patients. But nobody still knows how Mycobacterium makes these.
Okay.
So they've done some mass spec to find out that. And the pathway is not known. I know that this compound is there.
If there's no further questions, let us thank the speaker.